think a lot of that stuff really is kind of Bible reading, prayer, and we think, well, that's all stuff I'm doing towards God, but that's stuff I'm doing. And I would make an argument. I think there's a pretty significant component to that that is really just part of being creaturely. So it's, in other words, it's really part of your coram mundo responsibilities. And I would contend that, you know, a lot of people make the assumption that first table of the law is God stuff, second table is man stuff. But I would say the entire law, the whole Decalogue, commandments 1 through 10, including the first three, are really about what creatures do as good creatures. And so, in other words, when a creature is being a good creature, he worships God. He honors God. And so then part of that is, you know, worshiping, going to church, reading your Bible as part of your worship of God. And that's good for the creature, but it's also good for other creatures. And we all know what an encouragement it is, you know, when the people actually go to church and they see the young family going to church, that encourages others. And the old person who gets up at 4 in the morning to get to church by 8 o'clock, and that's an encouragement. And so there, it's not just so much I'm doing it for God, but you really are, I would argue, even serving your neighbor through your faithful participation in those things. So I know there is clearly a Godward component, no doubt about that. And honoring God is there. But there's also a horizontal component to it. There is. And this points out also what some of you have been kind of mentioning to me in, you know, in passing or between breaks, is the reality is, as the Christian, we live, like I said, at the nexus where these two things come together. So we're always living in both of these things. And there is clearly, as much as Luther wants to drive the two apart as far as possible, it's like heaven and earth apart from each other, they really impact each other a ton. And so having good habits impacts my standing, can make a good impact with how I hear God's word. And when I start doing things sloppily in the horizontal realm, can it have a negative impact on my relationship with God? Certainly it can. And so there's definitely a dynamic interaction between those things, even though, frankly, the reformers don't spend a lot of time on that. But it's there, and it's very real. All right, good? Now, so last time I was talking a little bit about the whole idea of the home and that aspect. So now I want to talk about state just a little bit. And this is intriguing to me. The last year or so, I had a sabbatical about a year ago, and the research I was doing, the reading, was primarily in this area of church-state stuff, or the two realms, what I've been calling the two realms, and I'm trying to avoid two kingdoms talk, but that's really not my lecture today, but I'm very interested in this stuff, and I'm spending a lot of time on this, and kind of what prompted it was I taught a grad-level class, on the two realms, the church-state stuff, and we read some stuff by a couple of Reformed guys, and they kept on talking about Luther's doctrine of the two kingdoms, and they were getting it wrong. It's getting it wrong, and it annoyed me. And so, and then I started doing more reading and stuff in there, and realized, just even from personal experience and things I've seen, you know, how many Lutherans get this wrong? And I've come to realize that a lot of people don't get Luther's two kingdoms teaching very well. And even at the SEM, we don't teach it, spend a lot of time on it. And I'm thinking about the curriculum at St. Louis, and I think an entire curriculum, from what I know of, what everybody gets covered, you spend maybe an hour and a half on the topic of the two kingdoms. Maybe. At St. Louis. I don't know what Fort Wayne does. But it's not much. And it's pretty thin. And a lot of it, I don't know if it really gets communicated very well. So I started deciding I was going to do some work on this, and I've actually been working on a book, and it's about 90% done, so I'm getting close. Keep on trying to find time to crank out a few more pages. I'm working on this, trying to get the thing done. But because someone told me I should have it done before the election, but I don't know if that's going to happen now, but whatever. I'll get it done when it gets done. But what has really stood out to me as I'm digging into this is I wanted to start with Luther and say, what's Luther really doing? And people immediately think of, oh yeah, he wrote this essay in 1523 or 4, or maybe it's a little later, 26. I want to say it's a little early, 24. Temporal authority, to what extent it should be obeyed. And so that's kind of his seminal place. That's where he lays it all out. And then he's got a parallel essay, Whether Soldiers Too Can Be Saved, which are all about that same time, early 20s. And that's kind of where everybody goes. But Luther actually he came back to this quite a bit. And one of the places where he unpacked this a little bit more, which is quite intriguing to me, is when he was doing a commentary on Psalms. And also, I mentioned this morning about the left-right and Song of Solomon, you know, Dr. Robbie's discovery. When he was doing commentaries on Old Testament things, he'd throw church-state stuff in all the time. It came up a lot for him. So when he was doing a commentary on Psalm 82, which talks about the gods stand in the congregation, and it's clear from the Psalm 82, that the gods are referring to the leaders of the state. In other words, princes and kings. In other words, the leaders of the nation. These are the gods, little g, okay? And the Old Testament kind of language. So the gods stand in the congregation, and he goes on. So Luther takes the occasion to unpack this little 8-verse psalm, and he spends 30-some pages talking about what this psalm means, and it's basically another little treatise on church-state relationships and how this thing works. He does this a lot. It keeps on coming up for him, and I think one of the reasons why it kept coming up is because it was such a prominent thing he was dealing with all the time. And we like to think, oh yeah, Luther's two kingdoms. So we've got the left and the right, that's the state and that's the church. I'm in the church, I'll just leave the state alone. And that's kind of how the Reformed like to run with this. So we got this wall of separation, kind of Jeffersonian, so we just have the state over there doing state stuff, and we're in the church, don't get mixed up, don't get confused. And then the Reformed guys who like Luther are using it against the evangelicals who are trying to build a Christian America, bad idea, or the evangelicals who are trying to kind of elide running together church and state, so God, guts, and gun made America great, yay, rah. And they don't like that. And if you do like that, that's another topic, you're wrong. Okay, but I'm not really doing that one today, but I would love to. But that's not my topic for today, so I'll stay away from what I want to do. I was tempted just to kind of do that anyway this whole session, but I decided not to. So we're not trying to make America great again. That's not my goal, and it shouldn't be yours. It's not, and it really doesn't matter who we elect in November. America's going to go where America goes. And we vote with responsibility, but it's going to do what it's going to do. We have a different task, and that's to make sure that the church is faithful and to make sure that families are acting the way they need to act. And I think we've got to have our hands full there, frankly. All right? So that's kind of where I'm coming from on that. But Luther was dealing with this stuff a lot because it was just kept on being impinged on him. So Luther, you would think, okay, he's just a church guy. Man, you pay attention to what he's actually doing. He was continually dealing with stuff going on. The prince was doing this. The elector was doing this. Somebody wanted him from to do this, and he was doing things. In fact, when Luther died, do you remember what he was doing? He was on an errand to settle a dispute between two feuding brothers. A couple of princes who couldn't get along, and they were having a big fight. So Luther went there to try to settle this dispute. It was a left-hand mess he was dealing with. He did this stuff all the time. All the time. So his counsel on these things is far more interesting than we think it is. And the reality is that for Luther, his distinction between what we might call the left and the right, and I know I've told you before that's not his terminology favorite, but it's there. His distinction between the left and right is very permeable and very dynamic. Because in his opinion, these are both God's hands, and they should be working together to try to get things done. So they should be working in a very kind of lively relationship where there's cooperation between them, but not confusion, and there's distinction between them, but not a divorce. They are to be holding together. And when you understand this, it makes a ton of sense of what Luther actually does. For example, Luther would call on princes to suppress heresy. And we might say, well, that's the confusion of church and state. But in fact, it's quite consistent with how Luther would operate. If the state can step in and help the church, it should. And if the state's willing to do that, take it. It's great. No problem. But be careful. Don't let the state become the church. Don't let the church become the state. Keep your distinction. Don't get confused. So don't say the Pledge of Allegiance during the church service. Don't. Okay. I stepped on some toes there, too. Read my book. Okay. I'll make my case. I'm serious about that. That's confusion. That's not a good idea. But we do need to pray for our people and pray for those who are leaders and pray for the country and thank those who have served well and acknowledge our veterans and honor those vocations. Absolutely do that. But don't be patriotic in the church service. We're not carrying the patriotic water in our church service. We're there to do gospel, not to uphold the state. The state can uphold itself at football games. All right. So we are the church, but we're living in this relationship with the state. And what's that look like? So Luther says some rather remarkable things of what that looks like. And he surprises us sometimes. So in this Psalm 82, he actually gets into this a little bit. And I'm going to share with you a few tidbits from this thing, which is kind of interesting. Because his assumption, oh, this is nice. I got this table here now. Didn't have it before. I like that. So he gets into this a little bit, and he starts talking about what would it look like and what is the responsibility of this going on between the church and the state. So he says, first of all, what we expect. The state is there because God put it there. Whose prince is it? God's prince. And he rules by God's authority. But he's not there just to do whatever he wants because the prince must be submissive to God's will. Because remember I said that the state is in the business of justice. Well, whose justice is that? It's God's. And what's the basis of that justice? The law. What's law? God's natural law. So when the state isn't doing what it's supposed to do, is that okay? Of course not. Of course not. And they need to be called to task. And so Luther recognizes there is a way to call them to task and there is a responsibility. And believe it or not, all that I'm talking about is going to get back to vocation. I haven't forgotten. Because what I want to talk about now is the pastor's vocation over against the state. So we talked about, I talked this morning about the with the family. What is your vocation towards your family? What is your vocational responsibility as parent, as father, in your home, and towards your wife? Not much about that, but that's implicit there. So now, what about towards the state? And you might think, well, okay, I guess I should drive the speed limits, and I should pay my taxes, and I should encourage my people to pay their taxes and to be obedient. Fair enough. Luther's not content with that. He goes further. So here's what he says. This is page 48. This is volume 13 in Luther's works. And this is on Psalm 82. This is page 48. Now, in order that these proud gods, state, princes, government leaders, may be deprived of their defiant boastfulness when they think that no one is to judge them or rebuke them without being called a rebel, because remember, Luther has no tolerance for rebellion, a little peg is driven into them, and a club is laid beside the dog. Thus they are properly rebuked, boldly spoken to, and threatened sharply and hard, as this psalm does, for it says here, God stands in his congregation and judges the gods. That is, he rebukes them. So, Luther says, God rebukes the princes in the congregation. Now, where's this going to happen? For he keeps the upper hand over them and the right to judge them and does not make them gods in such a way as to abolish his own Godhead and let them do as they please as if they alone were gods over God. So, a prince is always submissive, or must be, to God's will. So the government leaders are not their own Lord, God's Lord. And of course, that's a problem we have in America. Because in America, what is the foundation of all authority? The people, of course. The people. That's how it works in a democracy. So in a democracy, the demos is the authority. So the final word in the American experiment is always the people. It's always been that way. Always been that way. When the people tended to be moral and thought God existed and were afraid of him, things went pretty well. Once the people decide God doesn't exist and they don't care, suddenly now the people do what they want, which is where we are today. And so it's not like we have to go back and fix things to get how things used to be. Things are just what they've always been. It's just the people have shifted. And so the problem is not trying to recapture America. America's going where America was always going to go. Once the people are the foundation, this is what you get. And so it's not like, oh my goodness, America's gone off the rails. We've forgotten our godly foundation. We don't have a godly foundation. We don't. We never did. We had a foundation on people. And if the people were moral, wonderful. If they're not, you get what you get. So you just keep straight what's going on here, guys. So anyway, the country is supposed to be submissive to God. If it's not, it's in violation of God's purpose. And God will always take care of that. God will always take care of that. Don't worry about it. So in the meantime, though, the club is laid beside the dog. On the contrary, it is God's will that these gods, the princes, be subject to his word and either listen to it or suffer all misfortune. It is enough that they have to have rule over everything else. Over God's word, they are not to have it. So they don't get to trump God. So when the state says, this is the way it is, this is true, the church just says, no, it's not. And God says, no, it's not. And you will suffer the misfortune for your foolish, boastful position. It's reality. And the misfortune might take decades to unravel, but it will. So you just think back in history. When Rome decided it was no longer going to be a moral empire and was going to embrace decadence, what happens to Rome? I mean, it's not hard to figure this stuff out, guys. For God's word appoints them, makes them gods, and subjects everything to them. Therefore, they are not to despise it, for it is their institutor and appointer. For they are to be subject to it, the word of God, and allow themselves to be judged, rebuked, made, and corrected by it. Where then is God? Or how do we become sure that there is a God who thus rebukes? Answer, you hear in this place that he stands in the congregation. Where his congregation is, there you will find him, God. For there God has appointed his priests and preachers to whom he has committed the duty of teaching, exhorting, rebuking, comforting, in a word, of preaching the word of God. How it has been commanded to preach the word of God in all the world and every place, I cannot tell here. Observe, however, that a preacher by whom God rebukes the gods is to stand in the congregation. He is to stand, that is, to be firm and confident and deal uprightly and honestly with it, and in the congregation, that is, openly and boldly before God and men. What's he suggesting? What's Luther suggesting? Who's supposed to hold these princes to account? Who's going to call them to task? Who's going to say, stop doing what you're doing? What's Luther's assumption? Who's going to do this? The church is. And who speaks for the church? You do. You do. Called servant of the word. You are the spokesman. You're the guy who speaks for the church. You are supposed to stand there in the congregation and speak God's truth and rebuke and encourage and comfort and declare the whole word of God to everybody who listens. And that means when the prince is wrong, who's supposed to say something? You are. Wow, what happened to the separation of church and state? Now, this is making you uncomfortable because you have had this as a sacred cow for so long. Separation of church and state, Jefferson, wall of separation. Oh, no politics in the church, no politics, no, just gospel. Listen to Luther. If you're going to preach the whole counsel of God, do you preach to the prince and say, knock it off? So what's that mean today in America? We don't have princes running around. We have elected officials. So when elected officials are violating God's purposes, should the church be silent? No, my friend, no. So Luther goes on. These are the lazy and worthless preachers who do not tell the princes and lords their sins. In some cases, they do not notice the sins. They lie down and snore in their office and do nothing that pertains to it, except like swine, they take up the room where a good preacher should stand. These form the great majority. Luther's always so optimistic about the office. Page 50, he goes on, if you are in the ministry and are not willing to rebuke your gods openly and publicly as your office demands, at least leave off your private backbiting, calling of names, criticizing, complaining, or go hang. What's he saying? Don't go griping about Obama to your elders or to your wife or to anybody who will listen, but then are quiet in the pulpit. You can go hang. Don't do it. You need to be open and say, this is what God's word says, this is why it's wrong, this is what's wrong. And then you leave off all your griping and complaining and criticizing. That's inappropriate. You're supposed to have respect for the man in office, but when the man in the office isn't doing what he's supposed to do, you call him to task. You do it. Now, if he's not sitting in the pew listening to you, oh well, at least your people are hearing you address it. And guess what? Your people learn, oh yeah, God's word has something to say about this. And this is a sidebar, but this is really important to me. The congregation needs to know what God thinks about this stuff. Don't assume they do. Because they are getting a steady diet from the world all the time telling them how to think about gay rights and homosexual things and abortion and all this stuff, and their world is telling them how to think about all this stuff, and it's not what God thinks. And if they never hear from the church what God thinks about this stuff, how are they supposed to know? And if they never hear that this is wrong and opposed to God's will, who's going to tell them? So we have a responsibility, guys. This is fascinating, I think. This is Luther again. I'm going to ignore you for now. I'm on a roll. Let me roll. All right.
You said I could raise my hand.
You did, and I said I could ignore you, so I will. All right. But if you are not in office, then leave off all rebuking, criticizing, both public and private. Don't do it. Now, it's a little different in America. You can complain and vote, but he's basically saying here, you don't have that responsibility. Or the devil is already your abbot and does not need to become your abbot. God has forbidden secret judging or judging where there is no office. On the other hand, it is his will that those who are in office and are called to do so shall rebuke and judge their gods boldly and openly. To rebuke rulers in this way is, on the contrary, a praiseworthy, noble, and rare virtue and a particularly great service to God, as the psalm here proves. And he wraps it up. For a preacher is neither a courtier nor a hired hand. He is God's servant and slave. And his commission is over lords and slaves, as the psalm says. He judges and rebukes the gods. This is the meaning of the word judge, that is, by judgment and law. He is to do what is right and proper, not with a view to favor or disfavor, but according to law, that is, according to God's word, which knows no distinction or respect of persons. You see, this is opening a whole other realm here. Your vocation as pastor, when it comes to the state, is to help the state figure out what God wants it to do. and to teach it and to teach your people about what the state wants it to do. So we should be doing this. So is politics a fair topic from the pulpit? The answer is yes. Yes, yes, yes. Now, it doesn't mean you need to weigh in on every little thing going through the pipeline in Washington, D.C. Don't do that. Show some wisdom and discretion here. You address the things that are critically important. You address the things primarily that impinge on God's moral law. So when God's moral law is being violated and being run over, the church should say, stop. That's not right. You shouldn't do that. That's not appropriate. That's what the church does. And this is exactly what Luther's getting at. This is Luther saying this. So this old idea that somehow Luther's church and state is a division of church and state, we just kind of leave alone, and that leads to the quietism that we're all embarrassed by when it happens in Germany, but, oh, we don't do that in America. You guys, it does still happen. We have this notion that somehow church, state, never the twain shall meet, and we become quietists in our own way. And we can't be that way. But we also have to be very careful that we're not trying to build a Christian America. We're not trying to save America for the sake of Christ or something like this. We're simply wanting America to be what God wants it to be, a just nation that upholds His will and His law. And so when we have abortion on demand, that's not just. We need to say something about it. And by the way, while we're getting really complicated, and if I haven't offended you yet, I'll try to do it now. What about immigration? And what is the Christian attitude towards immigrants in our midst? Scripture has some pretty strong things to say about how to handle the stranger in your midst. And it doesn't usually say pack them up and ship them out. It says something about treat them like they're your own and show kindness and love to that stranger in your midst. And so, frankly, the church needs to be a little careful on whose side we're coming down on these immigration issues and what we're getting all fired up about who we should vote for because of immigration laws. And we should be having a much more open attitude by saying we have a responsibility to share God's love with everybody, and that means left hand Coram Mundo and right hand Coram Deo, and we need to be concerned for this. And frankly, a lot of the immigration talk I hear going on right now in this political rhetoric is not very Christian. It's just not very Christian. And that's going to put you in some weird places with some of your people, and that might make you have to push against them a little bit. But you need to come to terms with this and figure out, really, am I just being jingoistic, or am I actually being Christian in my position on these things? And there's a lot of jingoism going on here. And I start hearing people say, well, we're going to water down America if we just let everybody in. I'm thinking, so? Who says that's the final thing? Seriously, we're trying to protect America? From what? For what? What are you, a citizen of America, or are you a Christian? What are you? All right, sorry about that. All right. No, I'm not. You're right. I'm not sorry. You're quite right. I'm not. If I offended you, deal with it. All right. Okay, that's that. So we go on here. Now, a little encouragement for you. A little encouragement. Same document. And I'm just going to, these are where Luther's going a little further forward. And now he's comparing these princes who are investing in all these things and think the things are important. And now he's going to build you guys up as pastors. This is a nice section. This is page 52. He writes, who is this prince? And where are the eyes that can see this virtue in a lord or prince? To support or protect a poor, pious pastor is an act that makes no show and looks like a small thing. But to build a marble church, to give it golden ornaments, and to serve dead stone and wood, that makes a show that glitters. That is a virtue worthy of a king or a prince. So he's talking about the problem he has in his day where princes are supposed to be taking care of the church because that's where you got your income, but these princes kind of let things slide. Luther, we have documents where Luther was having to ask for fabric to make some new clothes for himself, and he had to ask the elector for this. He was dependent on the elector for these kinds of things. So that's what Luther's complaining about. Come on, support the lowly pastor instead of putting all your money to these big fancy things. So then he goes on, he says, well, let it make its show, let it glitter. Meanwhile, my pastor, who does not glitter, is practicing the virtue that increases God's kingdom, fills heaven with saints, plunders hell, robs the devil, wards off death, represses sin, instructs and comforts every man in the world according to his station in life, preserves peace and unity, raises fine young folk, and plants all kinds of virtue in the people. In a word, he is making a new world. That's what pastors do. But now, think back to that list. Does he say, meanwhile, my pastor is making saints for heaven, and that's the end of it? Think about what he just said in terms of what I've been teaching about the two realms and how important the coram mundo is. So what does he do? He plunders hell. Great. Making saints. Robs the devil. Wards off death. Represses sin. Great, great. Then he goes on. Comforts every man in the world according to his station in life. Vocation. Preserves peace and unity. Raises fine young folk. And plants all kinds of virtue in the people. That's all horizontal stuff. And pastors do that. It's what you do. And you do it just by grinding out the work, teaching people God's word, God's will, helping people know their vocations. So part of your responsibility to the state, frankly, is raising up decent people to be decent citizens. And that's one of the reasons why Jefferson wanted the church to exist. He wanted moral people. Because as they often say, our country will never work with an immoral people, which is why we're in serious trouble. So this is one of the issues that how we help our state. We help our state by raising people to be moral, raising them to be upright, helping them to know what it means to be a good citizen in the world. Now, question.
Okay. So in terms of speaking against political issues, are you saying name names?
I'm saying
speak issues. Because speaking the political issue is much greater accepted among the masses.
Yeah.
Until you start mentioning political leaders,
yeah.
And then the defenses go up, and then pastor is a Republican or pastor.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So, yeah. No, I get that, and I would say you probably name names as you need to. Luther did.
Okay.
He would name names. He would call people out by name, and he would do this. And so there's a time for this. And I know one of the things lurking in the background here, and this is getting into a whole other topic, this is another seminar, but this is something I'll just address quickly. What's lurking in the background here is, we can't do that because that's, against our tax-exempt status something. We can't get political or we'll lose that. And I guess my response is, fine, let's lose it. It's for too long the church has been compliant to our fear of losing tax-exempt status, and it makes us quiet. And I would challenge you guys on this. If you ever catch yourself holding back and saying what you think you should say because, we might jeopardize something, then you're wrong. You need to say what needs to be said, regardless what the impact might be. And tax-exempt status, frankly, is nothing more than one last vestige of Constantinianism. And it's not good for the church, frankly. We can enjoy it and take it for a free ride while we have it, but the day is going to come and it's going to go away. And it's just a matter of how long it's going to take. Probably longer than some people are predicting, but I think probably in, 3 or 4 decades, it'll be gone, if the country's still around. It'll be gone. And then we'll have to just deal with paying our own way. But that's okay. I knew I was going to do this because I'm interested in these things. I care about this. But if that happens, okay. Is the church going to go belly up? Come on. This is the Church of Christ we're talking about. It's going to outlast anything in the world. It's going to outlast emperors and princes and kings and lousy governments. It's going to do that. It's God's church. And the other thing that should give us great encouragement is the church today is starting to look a lot more like the church in the day of St. Paul. And not much like the church in the day of Luther. In fact, to try to translate Luther to today, you have to work a little bit because he had all this Constantinianism in his day, and he was applying his principles in his context. So we take the same principles and apply them in our context, but when we apply them, it starts looking a lot like St. Paul's world. So in St. Paul's world, how privileged was the Christian church? Now, how much was it a mover and shaker in the halls of Congress? Come on. Anybody consult Paul about what he thought about something when they were making decisions in Rome? No, no one cared. Who are you? Who cares? How did the church do in that context? It was crushed and silenced. No! What did it do? Grew gangbusters. Wow! Huh. Maybe the church will be all right if America takes away our privilege. And I'm just real blunt here. I am tired of hearing the church whining and complaining about losing its privilege. We should not be talking this way. And the church should not be out fighting for its rights. Nonsense. You look like you're the Red Cross fighting for your place at the pig trough. Knock it off. Be the church. Grow up. Be the church. Yes?
Yeah, but you know that Paul, the church of Christians, to obey the emperor.
Yes.
And pay taxes and honor to monarchs.
That's right.
And raising up good citizens would definitely include citizens who obey the law.
Correct.
And there are laws regulating immigration.
Correct.
It doesn't necessarily mean you're against immigration.
No, I agree.
I wasn't sure if you were referring to any apostles.
No. What I'm saying is maybe the law should be changed, and maybe Christians should be on the forefront fighting for the change. Right. No, I agree. The law should be obeyed, but I'm also arguing that perhaps as Christians we should be pushing for the laws to be changed instead of calling it amnesty and getting all worked up. And so maybe we should be rethinking where we stand on things. So fair enough. All right, I don't know why it keeps on doing this. I don't want free Wi-Fi. Let me get rid of that. All right. See if I can figure out why it's going that. That's Titcomb Basin. That's in Wyoming. My son and I camped right here. And we came down this ridge. Anyway. Sorry, I'll try to get my thing back. This is what you really care about. All right. Wow. Okay, here we go. Sorry about that. All right, so now one more little tidbit from the same document. This is just a little humor to make your life a little more enjoyable. Well, not miserable, this is enjoyable. This is page 56. I must remember here my monks and priests. This is actually relevant because he's going to slam monks and priests again, who have the reputation of carrying heaven on their shoulders in their acts of worship, though in reality they are the great whale, Kunsthildebrand, which was kind of a mythical figure everybody made fun of, which carries the world on its tail, as the peasants say. What are all these compared with one man who lives in this divine office? So what Luther's saying here is all these monks and priests are nothing compared to one prince doing his job well. And again, what's this about vocation? The prince is doing his vocation. The monks and the priests aren't. They're turning their back on their vocation. So he derides them. But now here's Luther being Luther. They are lapdogs, these monks and princes, that lie on pillows and whistle with their hind ends. Just Luther. But not to insult them. I think they are about as useful in the world as the rust on the iron, for they are just as much good to the world or to this divine office as the rust on his tools is to a carpenter. Nay, I shall name the very best of them, the hermits like Hilary, Jerome, and the rest, who have their great reputation because of the holy hermit life they led. If wishing could do it, I would rather be a pious secretary or tax collector for one of these gods than twice a Hilary or a Jerome among the angels. Even though my little pen or miserable penny would make less show in the world's eyes than their gray beards and wrinkled skin, I should not worry about that if only I were a partaker of all those divine virtues of government of which I have spoken. Wow! He'd rather be a tax collector than the greatest hermit that ever lived. Why? Because you're doing what God put you here to do in your vocation instead of running off doing your own silly stuff. You see how Luther just praises vocation and the kind of the way he says this, he's making some strong points here. So vocation is holy work. It's holy before God. And it's holier than the work of monks or nuns who are running around doing their holiness and really accomplishing nothing. Luther's pretty clear on this. So what do you owe the state? Well, you owe the state your obedience, but you also owe the state the rebuke when it's out of line. And you, the church, need to do this. This opens an entire huge can of worms, and it gets super complicated, and there's all kinds of good counsel. Robert Benny's written on this, C.T. Sharers has touched on these things, and there's some good help here on how to go about this. But the church needs to get over its fear of being political, or get over its fear of somehow, well, that's not my responsibility. Your people are living lives that are getting touched on by all these things. You've got to give them direction and counsel. You've got to help them sort these things out. We've got to deal with this stuff. Here it comes again. Wow. Oh, well. All right, good. So I won't close it, I'll just ignore it. And maybe it won't keep on bothering me. All right, so we've got that. That's good. And let's move on now to, I mentioned before Gustav Vingren just a little bit. And I want to kind of wrap up this whole idea of the church and the state and what's going on here and how this is supposed to hold together and how this is supposed to work. And I'm going to just offer just a quick quote here from Gustav Vingren. This is from a journal he wrote. And he lays out here, I think, really nicely, in summary, how we need to think about these two relationships, our relationship to God and our relationship to the world, and how these things come together and where we live in them. So he writes this. In heaven, Christ reigns with his gospel, that is to say, with pure giving and grace. Man enters this heavenly kingdom through faith, which receives and lays hold on the gospel and thereby on Christ himself. All right, so what he's just dealt with there very beautifully is the whole vertical relationship. So in that vertical relationship, it's all about faith, and it's all about Christ, and it's all about the gospel. And then he says, but the neighbor lives on earth, and one does not believe and trust in him. One does not receive salvation from him, but rather serves the neighbor in one's daily work. So the neighbor lives on earth. The neighbor lives on earth. We may set forth the following proposition. If man seeks to take the works which God commands him to do and bring these works before God, man thereby abolishes God's order both in heaven and on earth. For in heaven, the gospel reigns alone. Here to seek to place works before God as a means of justification is an attempt to depose Christ from his throne. So here we have the throne and Christ is enthroned. All right. Man allows his works to compete with the King of Heaven. But at the same time, the neighbor is pushed aside in the earthly kingdom. For works are not done for the neighbor's sake, but in order that I might adorn myself with them before God. Christ is dethroned in heaven, and the neighbor is dethroned on earth. Now the interesting thing here, implicit in his argument then, is if Christ is enthroned in heaven, who's enthroned on earth? The neighbor is. The neighbor is enthroned on earth. So who inhabits that heaven, that earthly throne? The neighbor does. What this means then is that when I am doing my works, my good works, my target, my object is the neighbor. Doing it for him. Doing him his service, what he needs. I'm doing it to serve him. And Christ is enthroned in heaven, and I'm receiving from him everything, and so it's all the gospel, it's all the passive righteousness, it's all what I get from him. But in the horizontal realm, it's the neighbor who's enthroned. And then Bindwin says, if you take a creature and put him on the throne in heaven, that's idolatry. It's wrong. But if I put Christ on the throne in the earth and think I'm serving Christ in my good works, I'm actually supplanting the neighbor and treating the neighbor as nothing more than a means to my righteousness before God. And I'm trivializing my neighbor. I'm not honoring him. And so what Vingren is teaching us here, and Vingren's this Swedish theologian from the late 20th century, what Vingren is teaching us here is that Christ is the center of my things coram Deo, but it's the neighbor who's the center coram mundo. So that, back to my analogy, when I get up in the morning, I say, what should I do today? My focus should not be on what am I going to do for God, but it should be what am I going to do for my neighbor? And serving God, really, for a Christian, is just shorthand for doing what God put me here to do. And what God put me here to do is to serve my neighbor. And so even you in the pastoral office, what are you doing? You're serving your neighbor, your flock. You do it by bringing them the comfort of God's Word. You do it by teaching them. You do it by instructing them. You do it by offering the gospel. You do it by visiting them in the nursing home. You do it by helping them through grief. You serve your neighbor. Your sheep are your object. Your object is not Christ. You simply receive from him. You're serving your neighbor. This is kind of a wild thought, but I think it's really helpful on this whole vocation thing. So the vocation then is aimed at the neighbor. It's aimed at the needs of those around me. So the neighbor being those, first of all, in my immediate family, that whole home responsibility. My wife, my kids, what do they need from me? How do I serve them? And then my neighbor being the state. What does the government need from me? How do I serve them? What do I need to do? What's my neighbor need? And then what about the people in my flock? What do they need? Who needs encouragement today? Who needs a visit from me today? Who needs to hear a good sermon on Sunday, so I better work on that? See, everything you do, I would say, in your office, everything you do in your vocation is always aimed out at your neighbor. God's informing it. God's giving it to you. God's directing the performance of it. He gives you guidance on how you should do it, but you're doing it for the sake of your neighbor. He's the object. You're not serving Christ. And see, even the parable of the sheep and the goats confirms this. Because you remember the parable of the sheep and the goats, Matthew 25, where you have the sheep who are being praised by the Lord because you visited me in prison and you clothed me and you fed me. And the sheep say, when did this happen? Well, every time you did it for the least of these, you did it for me. And so you say, ah, you see, it's really for Jesus. But the sheep didn't know it. The sheep didn't know it. When the sheep were doing what sheep are supposed to do, what were they doing? They saw others who needed something and they did it. They took care of it. They took care of them. They didn't run around saying, what am I going to do for Jesus today? And this, I think, should color a little bit how we even think about the ministry and the things we do, even in our service. So when the church is doing mission and doing ministry, we should be actually thinking, what are the actual needs of people in this community? What do they need from us? What can we do for them in a left-hand way? And it's just the left-hand thing. And you don't need to somehow put a gospel hook in it somehow to make it Jesus-ified. It doesn't have to happen. You don't have to baptize every action the church does to somehow make it okay. Sometimes you just do what needs to be done for the sake of the people around, and you meet their needs and you care for them. And in the process, you also then are going to open opportunities for further dialogue, which is pretty cool. But the left hand is its own legitimate thing. So you serve the neighbor. That's the object. And that's a good thing. So that's coming from Vingren's insights. And I think he's right on the money there. So I applaud that. All right. Now, I want to kind of push to the end here. And then I do have another Q&A time after a break, and so I'm going to defer questions until then primarily, and trying to push through a little bit more on wrapping this thing up. And I mentioned before Bonhoeffer and some of his work. And I want to spend a little bit more time on some of the insights he gives us, because he has a nice way of kind of starting to pull this thing together, and then I want to reflect a little bit on mission and how this thing works and what this might look like if we start actually kind of getting it into action and how this would kind of play out as we do this. So the where I want to go is from Bonhoeffer's Ethics. And this is available in print in all kinds of different editions. Bonhoeffer was working on this when he was in prison after he had been arrested. And so it comes to us kind of piecemeal. And in fact, the Ethics was never complete. He didn't get it wrapped up. He didn't have a chance to edit the whole thing. So he was writing chapters or essays, and then they were getting smuggled out by sympathetic guards, and there were plenty of those. And so we have these kind of in pieces. And so when you buy his Ethics and read it, people arrange it differently. It all kind of depends on what the editor decided was the right thing to do. So it's not like an authoritative thing. But he has one chapter in his Ethics called Christ, Reality, and Good, which is quite an exceptional piece and very strong and very nice. And he makes the argument in here that what Christ does is he pulls everything together in this wonderful unity. And that's where I want to kind of wrap this thing up and try to pull in pieces together. Because vocation can start to look kind of split off. Because we think about our work and our labor, and we think about our work at home, and we think about our work toward the state, and then we think about our work and our responsibilities toward the church. And by the way, the church is an area of service. And so it's easy for you to see. You spend all your time there, you know, writing sermons, visiting people. Wow, that's vocation. But even for your lay people, they have vocational responsibilities at church, like go to church and give a gift, give a tithe, give support, and pray for others. That's part of their responsibility they play out at church for the sake of the left-hand realm. So Bonhoeffer says it's really easy to start seeing these things kind of fracturing apart and start blowing apart into kind of, you know, this kind of competing things, and it gets really hard. So what holds us all together is the unity that comes in Christ and how Christ pulls this all together, and we have what he calls the reality of Christ. And so Bonhoeffer talks in here a lot about reality. And what he means is two things. He says, Christ is reality, but then so is the world. And instead of putting these things at odds and pulling them apart into kind of neat divisions, what we see is they come together in the reality of who Christ is. Christ is the Redeemer of the world. Christ is the one who makes us right before God, but Christ is the one who puts us in the world and sends us into the world and is redeeming the world. So these all come together, and these find their unity in the reality of who we are in Christ. This is kind of what Bonhoeffer's getting at. So then he wraps up this section. Before I get there, I'll get to his mandates in a minute and kind of walk through those and then pull this all together. But before I do that, I wanted to read just one more part from Bonhoeffer, and this kind of will maybe give you some insight into where I'm getting a little bit fired up about this, what the church should be doing with the state. It's page 200 in his Ethics, the translation I have. About five lines in or so, he writes this: the church has neither the wish nor the obligation to extend her space to cover the space of the world. She asks for no more space than she needs for the purpose of serving the world by bearing witness to Jesus Christ and to the reconciliation of the world with God through him. So in other words, the church does not have designs of taking over the world. Church is not interested in telling the world how to run the world, telling the world how to be the world. We're not interested in that. We're not trying to take over the world. It's not our interest. So we don't have those designs. All we want to do is simply bear witness to Christ. That's what the church wants to do. We want to bear witness to Christ. And if the church is able to bear witness to Christ, that's enough. And what are we bearing witness to? Christ's, the reconciliation of the world to God. So there you have this whole idea again. So the reconciliation of the world to God. So it's the whole world that's getting reconciled in Christ, and the church tells the world this. That's what we do. We're helping the world get right with God again. The only way in which the church can defend her territory, our place in the world, is by fighting not for it, but for the salvation of the world. Otherwise, the church becomes a religious society, which fights in its own interest and thereby ceases at once to be the church of God and of the world. And so the first demand which is made of those who belong to God's church is not that they should be something in themselves, not that they should, for example, set up some religious organization or that they should lead lives of piety, but that they shall be witnesses to Jesus Christ before the world. That's what you're here for. You're a witness to Jesus Christ before the world. And what I find really intriguing about what Bonhoeffer says is the church does not try to defend its own space in the world. We're not out trying to justify our existence or trying to win our place. And what does this translate to today? I think it really does translate to, oh, we should be fighting for our rights and making sure that nobody infringes on our Second Amendment rights to, you know, do whatever we want because we have rights. Do we? Do we? Do Christians have rights? You know, where do you stand before God? You go to God, I have rights. You're defending my, you're violating my rights, God. Well, we don't have rights. Now, as citizens of the country, we're given privileges, in which the state calls rights. Okay, so we have these available to us. But when the church starts to try to defend its rights or to demand its rights, what's that look like to the rest of the world? It looks like we're just one more organization demanding our slice of the pie and wanting our fair share. And it almost looks like we believe that somehow the government has the ability to give or take away rights from us. Like somehow we have to appeal to them because they're the final authority on this stuff. The church needs to get a little more courage here and a little more understanding of its own self-identity. We are the church, and we don't live at the behest of the government. And we are not beholden to the government. And if the government wants to take away my rights, take them away. Whatever. I'm not going to go to court and defend my rights because church doesn't do this. And if the state starts taking stuff away from us, take it. Again, let's go back to the first century church. How did they live? How many rights did they have? How many privileges did they have? Was the government making life hard for them all the time, taking away stuff all the time? And the church died in that situation? Church thrived in that situation. And so we've got to get our perspective here and figure out what really matters. And I guess what I'm trying to say is there's a lot of kind of shrill alarm going up, and people in the church are getting really worried and kind of concerned that, wow, the government's starting to reach, we're losing things, and we gotta fight back. And I guess we need to hear Bonhoeffer, who says, you know, don't fight back. The only way you keep your place in the world is by fighting for the salvation of the world, not fighting for your own existence. We don't need to fight for our existence. We need to fight for the salvation of the world. And then that makes us relevant, and that gives us our reason for being and helps us move forward. Are things going to change? Probably a lot. But that's okay too. All right, good. So that's along the way. Now, Bonhoeffer wraps up this section, Christ, Reality, and Good, with a really nice section which he calls the Four Mandates. And what Bonhoeffer is doing here at the end of this section is he's unpacking this whole idea of these four mandates. And he has some nice things to say here. So he's talking about the four mandates of labor, our work, and of the home, and then of the state, and then finally of the church. Now, what we've talked about already is quite a bit. We've talked a lot about home. I gave you the fourth commandment and what Luther has to say there about children and parents. And with the state, I just got done giving you Psalm 82 and what Luther teaches us there about our responsibility toward the state. And I was just using a little more Bonhoeffer talking about that as well, what we actually owe the state and how we should carry that out. Labor, I'm not going to elaborate on that. Bonhoeffer talks about how all labor is always done in relation to Christ, whether we know it or not. And so even the pagan who is doing his job is actually doing God's purposes, whether he knows it or not. sometimes against his own desires, but he is. And then that leaves the church to talk about a little bit. And this is where Bonhoeffer is the most helpful, because he doesn't talk about so much the things we do at church or the things we should do or the things we have to do. But what he gets into is he talks a little bit more about how the church kind of holds everything together. So this is where he writes, "The whole man stands before the whole earthly and eternal reality, the reality which God has prepared for him in Jesus Christ. Man can live up to this reality only if he responds fully to the totality of the offer and the claim. The first three mandates are not designed to divide man up, to tear him asunder. They are concerned with the whole man before God, the Creator, Reconciler, and Redeemer. Reality, therefore, in all its multiplicity, is ultimately one. It is one in the incarnate God, Jesus Christ, and precisely this is the testimony which the church must give." So we've got to tell the world that everything is actually holding together underneath Christ. And so the church actually plays a role of kind of holding all this stuff together. So we have this incredible privileged position of being in the church, of helping people in the church learn how to hold all this together under Christ. Because we have lives that are busy and fractured and going all kinds of different directions, and people need to figure out, how does this all hold together? And it all holds together because Christ is the one who has put you here, who is coming back, who's redeeming everything, and he's the one who guides us in what we do. So everything is done under the light of Christ, under the light of the work. And we get to do this. We get to tell people this. We get to help them sort these things out. This is not much help in the nitty-gritty. Like, what do I do when I've got warring competition between my different vocations? How do I reconcile these things? But we can even guide people and help them figure things out, helping them prioritize the things that matter, helping them make choices between things that are getting in the way or things that are actually useful and things that should be done or maybe things that should not be done. And we can bring some clear guidance on this stuff and help things sort out. All right, good. Now, what does all this mean? What this means is, the mission of the church then becomes a little more clear, I think. And so what is the mission of Christ? What is the mission of the church? It should be clear now, I think. The mission of Christ is the redemption, the reconciliation of the world. That's the mission of Christ. It's the redemption of the world. So it's not enough when we simply, you know, hand somebody a Bible. It's the redemption of the world. That's what we're working for. And so this is left and right working together. And the church needs to be doing this work. So this defines what we do as the church. The church then is the spokesman of these things. We speak about this. We are the spokesman of the mission of Christ, and we are taking this to the world. And it helps enormously now to think about how this plays out in the two realms. So if we have needs in the world around us on a horizontal plane, and the neighbor has needs, can the church do something about that? Yes, absolutely. And in fact, I would argue it should do something about that. And this is how the church has always operated. Back to our first century church again. One of the things that church was known for, especially in the Roman Empire, was its strange stance on orphaned children. Because remember, the Romans had this rather bad habit of getting rid of kids they didn't want. And if they didn't get the kid aborted, when they had some things that were pretty crude, but usually what they would do is they had a child they didn't want, they just took it out in the woods and left it. Carried out in the countryside and left it. They called it exposing babies. You've heard about this, maybe you haven't. And so they did this pretty routinely. Well, the Christians had this strange habit of going out in the fields, in the woods, and finding these babies, and then what would they do? They'd take them home and raise them. And the Christians were kind of known for this. It was strange. You're burdening yourself. You're taking on this extra child. Yeah, but it's a gift from God. And so was there a need? Yeah. And they did something about it. What they could. The church, we don't need to be so grand and maybe grandiose in what we're trying to accomplish. It's kind of simple. You ask yourself, what are the needs of the people around here? And are the things that we, as the people of God in this church, can be doing to help these people? Should we? Yeah. Let's go ahead and do this. Now, is that the gospel? I would say no. No. It's a left-hand horizontal thing. And remember, the law runs the show on the left hand. So when you're being obedient to Christ's command and serving your neighbor, you're serving your neighbor. That's great. So if I have a food bank and I'm giving away food, is that the gospel? No. It's giving people food so they're not hungry. It's important. It's good. And if I tell people, give them some instruction on how they can have a better family life and do better in their parenting and have more obedient kids and give them some clear instruction, that's going to help them. Is that the gospel? No. It's just the law. But it's good. It has a place. And if I have a school and I provide education and I keep the tuition down and so parents can send their kids to that school and get a safe place for the kids to be taught, that can be good service to the community. It's all right. So, but see, that's all left-hand stuff, and it's all here in the horizontal realm. It's not the gospel. It's not the gospel. It's not gospel until I deal with the vertical relationship. And that's when I start talking about forgiveness of sins. And that's when I start talking about the reality of who you are in Christ. And so you have not really done gospel until you've opened your mouth and you've talked about Jesus. And I want to be very clear on this. There's a fair amount of confusion, I think, in the church now that we want to do work of service and works of mercy. It's great. That's not the gospel. It's not the gospel. You have to be able to articulate what Christ has done and bring people to know their forgiveness of sins in Christ. That's the gospel proclamation. And so the mission of Christ is to bring the fullness of God and the fullness of God's activity and work into the world and into the lives of people and dealing with the real situations they have and the real struggles they have and the real problems they have and helping them see those in the light of God's mercy but also in the light of His forgiveness. And so the cool thing then is this. Vocation, obviously, is happening here in the horizontal realm. And what we start getting then is kind of this picture of how it could work. A church that's functioning well, a church that has a good understanding of itself, is going to be equipping its people to understand their lives in the context of God's truth, His law, His will for His creation. And so I'm going to teach parents how to be good parents. I'm going to teach kids how to be obedient. I'm going to teach the large catechism. I'm going to teach the commandments. I'm going to instruct. I'm going to encourage fathers and mothers to give of themselves and give of their time for their children. I'm going to encourage people not to get distracted by chasing junk in the world. I'm going to encourage them to do well what God has given them to do so they do their vocations well and they honor God in their vocations. And the congregation then starts to become this rather dynamic place where we're encouraging each other to do the vocations God has given us and we're instructing this and we're expecting people to follow through on this and expecting these things. And there is a encouragement. There is an admonition. And as Luther says, you admonish and you exhort and you rebuke and you teach the whole counsel of God. You're not just delivering gospel all the time. You're also teaching and exhorting. That's part of what we do. So the church is that. It's not legalism. It's not selling out. It's not somehow, we're losing our focus. No, we're being the church. And so we help the church figure out what it means to be the church. And to be faithful and to live a Christian life, and we teach them this. So the vocation is really based on the law, which, as I said before, is the will of God. And so part of what we do in the church is we help people to learn to live into the law. And I believe this is exactly the way Scripture teaches us. Learn to live into the law, because the law is the purpose of God, is the will of God, and we should be busy about this. And when you got a church that's doing this, that the people are starting to take seriously their responsibilities and they're living these things, it's going to make an impact. It's going to be evident in their families. It's going to make an impact in how they work and how they carry things out. And they're going to start actually being interested in carrying this love, this message, this truth to the people around them. It's going to happen. It's going to start making an impact as they learn to live into the law. And what that's going to do is it's going to open all kinds of opportunities for interactions with other people. And so what we begin to have then is this vision of the church simply being the church, which means we are a community gathered around God's truth, celebrating His gifts and His mercy, and then striving to be what He wants us to be, and then encouraging others to come and be part of this and inviting them in. And you don't have to sell it too hard when people start seeing the difference it makes in how people are in the church. And I am convinced that's why the church in the first century was growing gangbusters, because the gospel was making an impact. It was changing people. They were different, and they couldn't help but notice, see how they love each other, see how they live. That's what made them unique. They didn't have to get the right program or the right ministry model or the right speakers to come and get them all fired up. All they had to do was simply be the church and be faithful. And take seriously what it means to be the church. And then that gave them all kinds of opportunities to make a difference and to be that salt and light in the world, and then to bring people in and to actually articulate and deliver the gospel message. And they need to do that. You speak the gospel message. So they go together here. So the mission of Christ is very holistic. It does include works of mercy and service and helping those in need. But let's keep straight. That's just taking care of their left-hand needs. And what that's doing is being kind and being the church. And then we also see the need to make them right before God and deliver their forgiveness of sins. But even our works of service are not simply an excuse or a pretense to get to the delivery of the gospel. They are legitimate in their own right. They are their own end. So you don't have to do a soup kitchen so that someday I can tell them the gospel. Or you don't have to say, we'll feed you if you listen to the sermon. Just feed them. Just feed them. And so you just meet the needs and you care for them. That is its own end. But then so is the proclamation of the gospel. And when opportunities are there, you make the gospel known. And by the way, let's just be clear on that too. I was asking my second year students the other day, so what do you talk about if you talk about the gospel? And it's kind of a simple question. What do you actually say? And some of them were a little befuddled. I don't know. What do you say? So I suggested perhaps the best thing to do is simply tell the narrative of God. Tell the story of what God has done. That's really what the gospel of forgiveness is God has created you. He's put you in the world, and you know you're not what you should be. But the good news is there is incredible forgiveness in Christ. And He makes everything new, and He puts you back with God where you belong. It's just that simple. But it needs to be said. And until we've actually opened our mouths and said that, we really haven't done evangelism. We really haven't done the full mission of Christ. So both parts need to be there. And what the church needs to start sorting out is, okay, so we can do this active, zealous works of service into the community. Great. And we also want to be clearly articulating the gospel message and delivering that and bringing that home to people. That has to be there too. And you then need to figure out how you keep that tight balance going. And you can. And you can. And you will. What I find intriguing about this perhaps overly simple model is you don't have to wait till you get to certain thresholds of growth to start implementing it. You know, see, you don't have to say, well, once we start worshiping 50, we can do this. Or once we get to our 125 threshold, we can do this. And when we get to 500, this. And when we get to 1,000, we can get our Starbucks. And then we, you know, then we're there. You don't have to wait to do stuff. Instead, you can say, right now, today, wherever I am in any ministry context, I can be faithful to what God has called me to be, and I can start teaching my people to be faithful to what they've been called to be. That's what it means to be the church. That's the life of the church. And it's not something we have to wait for. It happens now. Well, thank you. So, well, no, I'm sympathetic to you guys. You know, church attendance is sometimes discouraging, and you think, what are we going to do? But you take what God has given you, and you invest in that there. And one of the really exciting things is the smaller your community, the more you can do this. And the more ably you can do this, because you can actually invest in the lives of your people, get to know what's going on, talk to them about how they're disciplining their kids, and talk to them about how they're setting goals for their life, talk to them about their plans for retirement, whether those are really good plans or not. You can talk about all that stuff. You get involved in their lives. You help them figure these things out. And does the pastor have something to say about all that stuff? He does. Is it your business? Of course it is. You're the shepherd. Everything in their lives is your business. This is how it works. So Christians get to tell people how their sex lives work. That's what we do. You're the pastor. You tell people their sex life, who they can sleep with, who they can't sleep with. You get to do that. Tell them how to spend their money. You do that. And we need to help people learn these things and shape that community. And like I said, when that community starts to develop, it becomes its own beautiful, wonderful community. It's not ingrown, because the part of the very dynamic you teach them is your responsibility to serve out. It's always going to be very extrinsic. It's going to be very outward focused, serving those around, reaching out to those. And it's not complicated. You just figure out what needs to be done, and you do that. And then it creates such an exciting environment to be part of that kind of congregation, part of that community that is actually taking seriously the walk of Christ and then delighting in their forgiveness of sins. And it doesn't have to breed a legalistic, hung-up congregation. even though that's kind of that's the reputation. Oh, that's kind of legalistic. It's not legalistic. It's just being serious about following Christ. And can you delight in the gospel even while you're doing that? Of course you can. See, that's that nexus coming together again. You as the individual live at that nexus, and you as a Christian congregation live at that nexus. That's what Bonhoeffer means by the reality, the oneness, the unity. There's this wonderful unity so that the reality of who I am before God, that reality is there, and we also have the reality of who I am in the world. And so both my relationship to the world, sorry about that. Oh well, I guess I'm not going to do it right now. Not going to behave. So my relationship to the world and my relationship to God are both going to be bound together in one reality, and that's really what we call the church. So the church is not separated from the world. It's not other than the world, but it's grounded in the world, in its vocations in doing these things. So that's where I think mission and vocation start coming together. All right, further questions at this point? Yes. What is my mission statement? Wow, I can make this real easy. That's kind of crested. You don't have people investing hours and tons of man hours in writing mission statements anymore. But for me, the mission statement's really real simple. I just wanted to be the people of God in this place. And so it's not too complicated. The mission statement, I would say, would be Genesis 1, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. So I want to do my responsibilities coram mundo. And I want to bring people to the reality of Christ's reality in their forgiveness and sins in coram Deo. So I'm interested in those two aspects. That's it. And I think we need to pay attention to both axes and both aspects. So I'm thinking about my coram mundo responsibilities and my coram Deo realities. And so what's the mission of the church? Be faithful in all these things and cover both aspects. It's just that simple. We don't need to get so complicated. We don't need to keep on reinventing the wheel and trying to brand ourselves. I am tired of this, you know. The brand our mission, or brand our community, or brand our church. Just be the church and be who you are. And don't worry about all your marketing and your branding and all that silly stuff. Life gets a lot easier when you don't worry about that stuff. All right, yeah. 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 You know, those are good questions. And actually, the left hand, right hand sheds quite a bit of light on this, because so now we're bumping up into kind of a whole other animal. And this is the whole idea of fellowship questions is really kind of what's going on here. And so we have the question, so what about the evangelical church in the community? What can I do with them? And so, when it comes to questions of fellowship, there are two things we want to always recognize. We want to recognize, first of all, our unity in Christ, but we also want to recognize that doctrine matters. And so, in other words, doctrine matters, because doctrine is simply God's truth, and if God's truth is God's truth, then we should care about it. And when somebody's not teaching God's truth, that bothers us. It matters. We need to care about that. So while we can recognize there's a unity in Christ, we can also recognize there are differences. And we've always said, the church is kind of clear on this, and it's not just the Lutheran church, but the church through history, and Rome's pretty clear on this too, is that expressions of fellowship really are inappropriate, especially when it comes to the marks of the church. So in other words, we don't share pulpits, we don't share altars and celebrate the Lord's Supper when we act like when we're in unity, when we're not. So common worship, not a good idea, but common service in the world, absolutely appropriate. I don't think that's a problem. And so especially when it comes to like left-hand things, can I make common cause with an evangelical church and work with them, and together we're going to do a food bank? Fine. I have no problem with that. I don't have a concern with that. And can I make common cause with the Evangelical Alliance, and we're going to try to stop this guy who wants to build a new porn shop in town, because we really don't need that in this town. It's not going to help us. And we're going to go against that. Can you as a church get actively involved in trying to stop that guy from building the porn shop? I say, sure. Of course, this is part of just coram mundo righteousness, and it's a good thing. And you can make common cause with evangelicals. You can even make common cause with the National Organization of Women on that. Seriously, why not? because you're just fighting for something right in the quorum mundo realm and trying to get something done. And that can be appropriate. But you don't confuse that with thinking, oh, now we're all unified in our confession. No, you're not. There's still clear differences, but we can recognize that we have common cause in the quorum mundo realm. And as Christians, we also recognize there is a common bound in our Lord Christ, and we're looking forward to the day when all the differences are healed at the consummation. But in the meantime, we'll work where we can. And when we start thinking about left-hand, right-hand stuff, when it comes to left-hand things, there's room for common cause. When it comes to right-hand things, we tend to be more careful about that. Okay? Does that help?
Sure. I mean, I think clearly with the quorum mundo stuff is easier. But
right.
With evangelicals, I mean, we very well may be able to have enough agreement about the fact that they need to know about Jesus.
Sure. Yeah, and so we can encourage their active work of evangelism and try to help them. You know, I don't have a problem with that. But see, I think we should be doing those things because we want people to come into the fullness of God's truth. And so am I content if somebody, you know, joins the community of Christ, but it's a community that's got a faulty confession and they don't understand baptism correctly? I don't want that. I want them to get the fullness of Christ. And so I think that's why I'm going to be a little bit hesitant on how much I want to encourage their success in, you know, furthering heterodoxy. Okay? Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so we're working with current mundo.
Yeah.
With evangelical churches. Mm-hmm. And
I have no problem with that. I'm not Wisconsin Synod, so I can do that. Well, of course. Yeah, of course. I would say, and this gets a little bit sticky, this is another topic altogether on fellowship issues. But this is relevant. This is worth talking about. There are times when you need to be a witness to the world and you need to be faithful to your confession come into a tight, you know, kind of conflict there, and it gets tough. Praying with somebody who's of a different faith, to me, is not a violation of the marks of the church, because the prayer's never been a mark of the church, and that's one of the distinctions we make. So there's a difference between prayer and celebrating the Eucharist or sharing pulpits. There's a difference there, a difference in kind of level of our understanding of what's actually going on there, what it means to be fully engaged. And so having a prayer with a Roman Catholic or an evangelical before we go and do a peaceful protest at an abortion clinic, I have no problem with that. Okay, that's not an inappropriate thing. Having a joint community worship service when we're going to all pray for the end of abortion, but we're going to have a community worship service together, I'd be less inclined to embrace that.
Yeah, let me tighten this up a little bit.
Uh-huh.
With regard to the problem between the OCMS, the OS,
the wells, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's that mean?
What's that mean? I don't know. We'll see. I, you know, that's interesting. It's such a little blip in the big scope of things. We'll see if it means a lot or not. It's good that we're talking. I'm glad for that. I'm glad that we continue to dialogue. I'm of the opinion that we should be dialoguing with just about anybody who'll dialogue with us, and because we want to try to bring God's truth to them and call them back to the fullness of God's truth. And I believe we have it. And if I didn't think that, I wouldn't be here. So I have no problem with that, but I don't think it has that much impact on what we do. Oh, of course, of course. And so we just patiently listen and keep talking, yeah. All right, yeah. Go ahead, here.
This sounds like it would be best done in a house church. You taught a lot of young men going out recently.
Yeah.
One of them I know is Ted Torrance, and he's doing the exchange community.
Okay.
It sounds like he has a church that's doing this.
Okay. No. No, the question is, do I have a sample church? Can I hold up an example? I don't. And I'm not looking for one, honestly. I would rather every single one of you takes this to heart and says, wow, I can do that. And I don't have to emulate somebody. I don't have to follow a model. I don't have to buy anybody's software. I don't have to, you know, no offense to anybody. I don't have to get another three-ring binder on my shelf to figure this out. I can go home and I can start taking seriously the whole counsel of God, and my coram mundo responsibility is to be a shepherd who helps people live into their vocations and know what those look like and encourages them to do that, and at the same time clearly and joyfully preaches the forgiveness of sins in Christ. And I can do both of those things at once, and I need to take seriously both of those responsibilities. So my vocation as a shepherd is to help my people do their vocations. That's what I'm put here to do, and I want to help them do their vocations better and pay attention, and I want to start today. And I'm not going to copy some other dude, because every single community is different. Every single situation you guys are in are all different, and you cannot do, you know, well, I'm going to do like he did or like he did. You just need to say, I need to be faithful in my place, and here's what this is going to look like where I am, and it's time for me to start doing that. So that's kind of what I'm getting at, okay? So I'm just, it's not that complicated. I saw a hand over here. Yes?
I agree with you that the church should not get embroiled in the mission of trying to defend its rights or defend its privileges that it has, but on the other hand, isn't there sort of a stewardship education that should go on with American churches?
Yeah.
Where we teach the lay people, you are the government, you have
right.
A privilege, God has given you wonderful things by letting you be born in this nation under this constitution, and if you don't grab onto it and start advocating for it, it's going to be taken away.
All right. So the question is, what's the whole idea of the responsibility of the church to the state, but what's different about this living in a democratic republic like America where we have a stake and a role in it? And that's a good question, and it's something worth thinking about. Because, in fact, the world we're living in is not like Luther's. In Luther's world, the prince was the final authority, and you did what he said. And your only responsibility as a citizen was to shut up and support him and pay your taxes. That was it. We live in a democratic republic where we actually get to vote, and we get to influence legislators, we get to participate, we can even run for office if we want to. We can do all that stuff. And I think we do need to take seriously that, what it means to be a citizen in this kind of country. So it's not like it is in Luther's, but the principles still apply. So the principle is very simple. If I am a Christian first, this is who I am, it's my identity, and I'm living in this country of America, so I'm going to be a Christian living in America, so now I also have an American citizenship. What does that look like? How does that play out? How do I fulfill my responsibilities? So do I try to influence and shape the country according to God's purposes? Yes. Yes. So should I vote accordingly? Absolutely. Can I support candidates? Absolutely. Maybe I should run for office? Absolutely. And if I don't get involved, might the country continue to go off in crazy directions? Yeah, it might. And then in a sense, am I actually held responsible for that? In a sense, yeah. So I do have a responsibility. And this is why I've said in other contexts, which is maybe also provocative, but I think it's true. So if I'm in the voting booth, is it possible for me as a Christian to sin when I'm voting? And it is, of course. So can you vote for the wrong person and actually sin against God's purpose by how you vote? And I would say, absolutely you can. And you might say, well, does it mean there's a godly candidate? Not necessarily. So sometimes you have to sin either way, and you just ask for God's forgiveness on the way out of the voting booth. You know, but I was obedient, I went and voted. God, please forgive me. You know. Exactly. But to stay home and not vote is also a sin, and I would say a more grave sin, because you're neglecting your responsibility. And so you pick the lesser of evils and you do it. And the reality is, and see, maybe I haven't emphasized this nearly enough, but it's true, and this is worth emphasizing here. When you go into the left hand, it's messy. The left hand is messy. Things aren't neat and clean out there. It's a mess. And when you enter into the world of politics, it's really messy. And it's a thankless kind of a job. You have to make compromises. You have to deal with stuff. You're always trying to steer the world back kind of where it needs to belong. You're trying to call it back to justice. And so sometimes you have to do things that look repugnant. And frankly, a lot of people who are, you know, kind of seeing things in a hardcore God's will, not God's will. They can't figure out why a guy can vote for something that's actually allowing something not good, but it's moving things in the right direction. And that's how it works in the world sometimes. So it's messy out there. And when you're functioning in the left-hand world, you have to ask for God's forgiveness a lot. But that's okay. It's part of what you do living in that world, and you need to. You need to embrace it. I really believe if you start getting this stuff straight and thinking it through, what this should lead to is that Lutheran Christians should be some of the most socially active Christians in America. And we're not. And it's nuts. And we're not because we've misappropriated our heritage. We haven't listened to Luther. We've gotten this all goofed up. And we're dropping the ball on this stuff. So when we start getting straight what it actually means to be a Christian living in America, we should be engaged in trying to do things. Not to make a Christian America, but to make a just America. That's God's purpose. And we should be working for that. Even if it's not going to work. So what? You do it anyway, because it's what God has called you to do. All right. Okay. Yeah.
Being who we are. Secondly, you've given a great insight to that, thinking the distinction between justification and our sanctified life. I think sanctification preaching is a lot easier when taking these two realms.
Good. I agree. And I no, I, let me just elaborate on that just a little bit. And I'll what's that?
Just one paragraph.
Okay, all right. Well, I'll come back. I'll be your third in a minute. So let me just interject here. I have not used the word sanctification very much. And I didn't deliberately do that, but it's become commonplace for me. I don't talk about that word sanctification very much anymore at all, because I found it to be it's loaded with all kinds of baggage. And everybody thinks they know what it means, and it just creates all kinds of problems. And so I think you're exactly right. I think thinking in terms of the two kinds of righteousness or our two axes of responsibility is far more helpful, because it allows us to introduce new verbiage, which opens some new doors for us. Because people hear sanctification, and they often hear this as me and God cooperating after God makes me right. And it gets all messed up. And we're kind of cautious about this. And I think it opens new avenues for us to talk this way. And it's also, I think, important to remember in the Book of Concord, Article 6, which would, you got justification, you got office of the ministry, then you got Article 6, which should be sanctification. Actually, the title they put in was new obedience. And that's much better language. So what are you obedient to? God's will, His law. Go out and do what you need to do in the world. That's your obedience. In your vocations. So your vocations are where you're doing your obedience. Go do it. Go ahead. I would agree with that. And I think we become way too ingrown, and we're worried about preserving and protecting and keeping the congregation alive. And that shouldn't be our driving concern. Our driving concern is to proclaim the kingdom of Christ, whatever happens. And congregations don't need that much to take care of themselves. They just need a pastor, and you need to support the pastor. But buildings, whatever, we don't have to have all that stuff. And I guess I would even say the same thing really goes for synods. Will the church survive without a synod? Of course. And so we're not invested in trying to preserve a synod or preserve a congregation or preserve our institution. What we're interested in is the kingdom of Christ and His proclamation. All right, one more. Then I had a new angle I was going to bring up, but I will maybe do that in my second.
There's outreach into the world. It seems the church is always tempted to radicalize its culture, so to speak, to eliminate its hallmarks.
Yes.
It's ceremonies and its accoutrements and its symbolism. It's supposed to be tucked away. Understandably, we do want to reach them.
Right.
Horizontal.
Right.
What are we bringing them back when the gospel can be
spoken?
That's one thing.
Yeah, and you're opening up some interesting things. The whole idea of the uniqueness of the church's culture and how much do we accommodate ourselves. We want to be relevant, but I guess one of the things you're probably hearing me say, and I do am meaning to say this, that when the church is being faithful and being serious about doing this vocation and helping people do their vocation and serious about proclaiming Christ, it is relevant. It is relevant. And it's relevant at the most profound place, because people begin to realize, this is going to teach me how to be a real human being, which is what God created me to be, fully human. I'm going to do that now. And it teaches me how I can live with peace when I'm not feeling peace. These are the most important things we've got. This is relevant. This is what people are crying for. People in the world today are living without meaning. They're living pointless lives, and they're starting to realize this, and they're looking for something that can ground them and give them purpose. We're sitting on it. We have it. And so we have things that are profoundly relevant. We don't have to ape the world to be relevant. We can be who we are, and we're inherently relevant simply by being what we are. That's quite true. All right. Yeah, go ahead, Josh.
You talked about not using
Yes, you're right. Yeah.
Now,
third use of the law, I just I don't I believe in it, and I'm a big fan of that. But yeah, I haven't used that verbiage either. I know it gets bashed on, but I wasn't here to talk about law gospel or third use of law. But it is. This is basically teaching people what it means to do the law of God is comes out to becoming the third use, and that's a good thing, not a problem. All right, I'm at the end of my time here for this segment. When I come back at the afternoon segment, it won't just be Q&A. I want to start by talking about one of the problems you have with this, which is our vocations ever flexible, and we'll talk about that just for a little bit, then I'll do the rest of the time with Q&A. So that's that. All right.